SBS acknowledges the traditional custodians of country and their connections and continuous care for the skies, lands and waterways across Australia.
You're listening to Australia Explained, an SBS audio podcast helping you navigate life in Australia.
Sleep disturbances are common for people settling into their new home in Australia. Experts say it's expected and normal for your sleep quality to decline in the short term. But what if it turns into a chronic medical issue?
If it becomes a problem, like initiating or maintaining or continuing sleep for certain hours more than three times a week for several weeks, that's where they need to go and talk to their GP.
Welcome to Australia Explained. I'm your host, Melissa Compagnoni, and in today's episode, we look at sleep problems after migrating, when to take action, and the available options to help you and your loved ones. Ask anyone in your circle, and chances are their sleeping patterns will differ from yours. Fatima Yakut, a sleep scientist and epidemiologist and an associate professor at the University of Queensland, says sleep is a very subjective thing. In sleep health research, good quality sleep is defined based on several factors, including duration, ability to maintain uninterrupted sleep throughout the night, and the ability to fall asleep within 15 to 20 minutes of going to bed. But most importantly, it's the overall experience of how you feel when you wake up.
7 to 9 hours is recommended, but it can vary from person to person, and you are the best person to decide whether or not you need 7 hours, 9 hours. Then there's people who generally keep tossing and turning in bed for a very long time before they doze off to sleep. Their sleep is not considered great. And then if they are waking up regularly, it's also not a sign of healthy sleep. More importantly is how you feel when you wake up. That's the biggest indicator of how healthy your sleep is. If you feel refreshed and rested, then you had a good night's sleep.
Sleep habits and rest practices vary across cultures. For people coming from traditionally hotter climates, including Central and South America and the Mediterranean, taking a siesta, meaning an afternoon rest, is not uncommon. Associate Professor Yakut says daytime naps can be healthy as long as they're not lengthy.
Short nap, not more than 30 minutes, can help you with going through your day after having a long day or long morning. But if napping is like a mini sleep, more than half an hour, 20 minutes, then it does impact your nighttime sleep.
Sleep quality is also shaped by a person's responsibilities, work schedule, and roles. Moving to a new country is a big change, which often leads to disturbed sleep, at least for some time, Associate Professor Yakut explains.
People leave their home country, their family and their comfort zone. They come to a new place and there's job uncertainty, there's a new culture, a new society. So settling in takes time and there's jet lag. So it disrupts their sleep rhythm and increases their risk of experiencing poor sleep. Then if those stresses are not removed, that eventually leads to chronic sleep issues.
In Australian sleep health research, there's not an abundance of studies specifically for migrant populations. A 2019 Monash University study on sleep disturbance and its links to mental health and psychosocial issues focused on refugees and asylum seekers. It found that moderate to severe sleep issues were present in most of the study participants, both adults and children. Social worker Krista Senden, the practice leader at Foundation House, a Melbourne-based specialist refugee trauma agency, shares her insight.
Refugees and asylum seeker population sleep disturbance is one of the most common reported symptoms. In a study conducted in 2019, more than 75% of refugees and asylum seekers reported moderate to severe sleep disturbances. So we know people who experience post-traumatic stress disorder, sleep disturbances, it's actually one of the most persistent symptoms after treatment. So around 50% of people who have received some kind of treatment for their trauma report sleep disturbances continue.
But it's not just pre-arrival trauma, whether yours or a loved one's, that can affect your sleep. Migration and settlement factors also play a role, Ms. Senden says.
We know that cultural differences exist in sleep and awake patterns, but also settlement factors such as working shift that impacts keeping regular sleep cycles or staying up late or waking up early to kind of keep the hours of the country of origin so they can speak to loved ones or follow news or emerging events overseas impact the sleep patterns of the clients that we see.
Ms. Senden adds that migration stresses can affect your sleep, but the effect works both ways.
Be sure to know how to get support early on, because research suggests that there's a correlation between getting adequate sleep and recovering from trauma and recovering from the impact of migration stress.
Chris Seton is a pediatric and adolescent sleep physician at the Children's Hospital at Westmead in Western Sydney. He assesses and diagnoses sleep problems in children from newborns to 18-year-olds. A sleep problem is anything that a parent or a GP perceives as an issue or abnormal, he explains.
Sometimes people worry, you know, my son or daughter, should they go to the sleep clinic or should they not? And the way to tell is there a sleep problem there? Are they waking at night? Is their sleep disturbed? Do they have trouble getting to sleep? And really importantly, are they tired the next day? And sleep problems too affect the mental health of young people and cause a lot of stress. And again, people worry, you know, does my child's mood disorder cause a sleep problem, or does the sleep problem cause the mood to be depressed? It doesn't matter, because all these things are interrelated.
Dr. Seton says it's wrong to assume that families sleeping together will inevitably cause sleep problems. Co-sleeping only becomes an issue when it leads to sleep deprivation.
In its pure sense, we don't see co-sleeping as a medical problem or a health problem. We see it as a parent choice. There are particular cultures where co-sleeping is pretty much ubiquitous. So we in fact see lots of families who co-sleep, and what we say is that it's fine until it's not good. So not so good co-sleeping is where parents and child are getting less sleep than is optimal.
When a family reaches out to a sleep clinic, the doctor will implement a series of strategies to reinforce healthy sleeping habits for the child.
When we look and assess co-sleeping, we see it as a behaviour, and we do treat it. You know, if parents say we want to reverse it, and how we treat it is dependent a lot on the age of the child.
Dr. Seton says that co-sleeping and recurrent nightmares are more common in middle childhood, typically between 6 and 10 years of age. For teenagers, the most common cause of sleep problems is insomnia, often fuelled by stresses such as demanding daily schedules, parental expectations, and screen time at night. Migrant teens are even more vulnerable due to additional stresses related to moving to a new country, adapting to a new culture and language, and being away from childhood friends and extended family. Dr. Seton again.
So if a boy or girl has a vulnerability to anxiety or depression, two of the potent things in bringing that out are stress and or sleep deprivation. And one of the beauties of treating that sleep deprivation, it really elevates moods. It makes daytime stuff a lot easier. And it makes these kids much more resilient. The stresses are still there, but they cope with it better if they sleep well.
The same applies for adults facing insomnia or other sleep problems. Associate Professor Yakut advises reaching out for help as soon as you notice your sleep issues are repeated and impacting your functions and ability to focus.
If this is like a short-term change in their sleep, that's fine. But if it becomes a problem, like initiating or maintaining or continuing sleep for certain hours, more than 3 times a week for several weeks, that's where they need to go and talk to their GP, because these are signs of either insomnia or another underlying issue that's impacting their sleep.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Australia Explained, written and produced by Zoe Thomaidou. And I'm Melissa Compagnoni. Australia Explained Managing Editor is Rosa Germian.
Subscribe or follow the Australia Explained podcast for more valuable information and tips about settling into your new life in Australia. Do you have any questions or topic ideas? Send us an email to australiaexplained@sbs.com.au.
This was an SBS audio podcast. For more Australia Explained stories, visit sbs.com.au/Australia Explained.